Let us pray. God, open our ears to hear your word. Open our hearts to receive your word. Open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world around us. And open our lives to the infinite possibilities born of your love. Amen. The morning of January 3rd, 1984 started out like pretty much every other morning for Linda Burke. She managed a daycare in Virginia, and she arrived early to do all of the things that she needed to do to prepare for the children to arrive for her care. She was in her office getting ready for her day. She never heard the glass breaking in the front door of the daycare, nor did she hear the intruder who would come into the daycare coming up behind her. And even though her assailant would grab her from behind, she saw his face long enough and well enough, she believed, that she could identify him to absolutely anyone so that he could be apprehended. And so when the police came and talked to her and they showed her all kinds of pictures of potential suspects, she immediately saw a picture and she pointed to the picture and she said, "That's him. I know that is the man." Well, the man that she identified, a 19-year-old by the name of Thomas Hainsworth, maintained his innocence when he was apprehended. He said that he had been at home sleeping. And throughout the trial and throughout the whole ordeal, because he really didn't understand everything that was going on, he kept thinking, "Someone is going to figure out that I really didn't do this. Someone is going to figure that out." But he was tried, he was convicted, and he was sentenced to prison. And Linda Burke was left trying to pick up the pieces of her existence, trying deep down within herself to forgive this person who had taken away her sense of peace and safety and had left her literally terrified of being left alone. Time passed. Thomas Hainsworth was actually kind of a model prisoner. He completed 4 years of college studies. He studied 6 different trades. He worked in the prison kitchen. He never got into any altercations with anyone. He just seemed to keep to himself and exist well. 2 men in the state of Virginia were exonerated after their arrest record and trial record had been reviewed. And officials in Virginia decided that they might need to look at a few more of these cases. And Thomas Hainsworth's case came up for review. And wouldn't you know, DNA evidence very, very clearly revealed that he had never committed a crime against Linda Burke. By this point in time, Thomas Hainsworth had been in prison for 25 years. When the authorities went to her to tell her it's been proven that this man did not commit this crime. She said, how can that be? Because I know it was him. I saw his face. I know it was him. And the police said, no. He was actually a man who looked similar to him. And how we know that is that the DNA of the person who actually harmed you, we identified because he had committed crimes against others. And she then was left to try to figure out how she could make some kind of statement on his behalf, how she could do something to right this wrong. But she was afraid to see him, afraid to meet him, afraid to get near him, because she had no idea how she would ever explain to him what she had done. He was exonerated, he was freed, he got a job. He tried as best as he could to put the pieces of his life back together. But the one thing that hadn't happened, the one thing that was still hanging out there, was that no one had ever said to him, we're sorry. And time passed, and someone asked Linda Burke if she would meet Thomas Haynesworth. And she had no idea how to do that or what to say, but she went. And when she saw him, she just sobbed. And she said, I'm so sorry. I am so sorry. And he took her and he pulled her into his arms, into an embrace. And he said to her, somehow we'll get through this together. In an instant, in one moment, Linda Burke probably learned more about what it meant to be forgiven and to forgive than she had known in an entire lifetime. What does it mean when we have been wronged to forgive the person who has wronged and hurt us? We have this very interesting and provocative question that opens our lesson from Matthew's gospel today. And it's really unfortunate that this section, this particular passage that we have today, has been uncoupled from what we had last week, because it's really a continuing story of what it means for us to seek peace and reconciliation with one another. Our lesson today begins with Peter asking Jesus, so how many times do I have to forgive somebody? We're back to that Greek word adelphos that we encountered last week. If my brother sins against me, how many times must I forgive him? And if seven sounded like a big number, boy, was he in for a surprise when Jesus responded, no, not seven. Not seven, 77. So many times, maybe, that you have lost count, lost track, forgotten how many times you have actually forgiven, that many times you are called upon to forgive. And even for us, those words can sound startling and striking. Forgive until you just don't even remember how many times you have forgiven. And this is part of this whole notion of reconciliation that began with the lesson that we had last week. Because when we had that lesson last week, and we do need to go back and talk about that and couple these things together, what we saw last week was all of a sudden this notion of what does it mean to be reconciled with those who have harmed us and those who have done us wrong? And when someone sins, when that brother sins against us, Jesus doesn't say, walk off and be mad. Everybody go to your own corner. That is not what Jesus says. Jesus says, we need to talk about it. You need to go to that person who has harmed you and hurt you. You need to go and you need to talk to them. And if that doesn't work, take two or three more folks with you. If that doesn't work, then maybe the whole assembly needs to talk about this. And oh yeah, if even that doesn't work, we still don't give up on this brother. We don't give up. We understand ourselves to be kin. All to be children of God, all to be related to one another. And so because we are kin, we don't give up on our kinspeople. And we still greet them and welcome them as Jesus has already shown us in Matthew's gospel, the way that he has treated the Gentiles and the tax collectors when he has indeed welcomed them into his midst and brought healing into their lives. There's no giving up on our kinspeople. Because as God's beloved, we are all one. So now, the second piece of that is after we've talked about it, we got to do the really hard part, because the hard part might be forgiving for the 78th time. It's forgiving in love, so that we can be reconciled to one another and that we can pick up the pieces and go on with our existences. And he tells this parable about the Lord, the Master, who forgives a tremendous debt only to have the servant go out and fail to forgive a debt that is owed to him. Because Jesus says this isn't the way it's supposed to work, we are to remember how we are forgiven every day, how we are forgiven and shown mercy and compassion by our God every day. And it is that mercy and that compassion and that forgiveness that we are then to turn back to the world. How many times have we, who have been so loved, so cherished, so forgiven, forgotten what it means to love and to forgive, just as God has forgiven us? This path to reconciliation that Jesus has set forth in Matthew's gospel, this isn't easy. This is hard. It is hard to talk when we have been hurt, and it's hard to forgive when we have been hurt. But that is exactly what God calls us to do. to be people who reflect that kind of love, that kind of forgiveness, that kind of compassion back into the world so that others can see it and others may emulate it. That is what we are called to do and be. There isn't a promise that it will be easy. Matter of fact, it's probably going to be among the hardest things we've ever done. Ask Linda Burke and Thomas Hainsworth right now how hard that journey has been. It is a hard one, but it is one that is filled with grace and love. It is one that allows us to be reconciled with one another and to be able to live our lives as God would have us live them, fully and wholly. And so when we begin to ask ourselves, who do we need to forgive? Even this moment as we're sitting here, from whom do we need to ask forgiveness in our own lives? It is the reminder to us that God wants us to live in peace, that God wants us to live in reconciliation with one another. That is our connection. We can't give up on our kin, our sisters and brothers made by our Creator. We can't give up on one another because God does not give up on any of us. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.